Good afternoon. Today we celebrate the 13th Sunday in Ordinary Time. This weekend's special collection is for Peter's Pence, a collection for the works of the Holy Father. Thank you for your generosity. Please turn off all electronic devices. This Mass is being offered for all of us and our families, and especially for Marilyn and Joe Allen, Paige Brown, Virginia Avita, Jack Collada, Judge Patrick M. Schott, Joan Schott, Anthony E. Zapardo, Mr. and Mrs. Anthony L. Zapardo, Dr. and Mrs. Carl Colicchio, Sarah Champagne, Mr. and Mrs. Arthur Mons, Mary Ross Barrage, Brandon Epstein, Claudia Savoy, Sheila Lee Sheets, and special intentions of Laura Brinks, Matthew Brookshire, and Marilyn Clark. Also, full healing of Wes and Sandra Getz. Please rise and join in singing our opening hymn in your Brad Gather hymnal, number 586, Amazing Grace, number 586.
Almighty God and Prince of Peace, Lord have
mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are Son of God and Son of Mary, Christ have mercy.
Christ have
mercy. Lord Jesus, you are Word made flesh and splendor of the Father, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
We pray to you, we bless you, we adore you.
through the grace of adoption, chose us to be children of light. Grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped, in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. God did not make death, nor does he rejoice in the destruction of the living. For he fashioned all things that they might have being, and the creatures of the world were wholesome. And there is not a destructive drug among them, nor any domain of the underworld, of the netherworld on earth, for justice is undying. For God formed man to be imperishable, the image of his own nature, and made him. But by the envy of the devil, death entered the world, and they who belong to his company experience it. The word of the Lord. A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, as you excel in every respect, in faith, discourse, knowledge, all earnestness, and in the love we have for you, may you excel in this gracious act also. For you know the gracious act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, for your sake he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. Not that others should have relief while you are burdened, but that as a matter of equality,
your abundance at the present time should supply their needs, so that their abundance may also supply your needs, that there may be equality. As it is written, whoever had much did not have more, and whoever had little did not have less. The word of the Lord. Be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a large crowd gathered around him, and he stayed close to the sea. One of the synagogue officials named Jairus came forward. Seeing him, he fell at his feet and pleaded earnestly with him, saying, "My daughter is at the point of death. Please come lay your hands on her, that she may get well and live." He went off with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed upon him. There was a woman afflicted with hemorrhages for 12 years. She had suffered greatly at the hands of many doctors and had spent all that she had. Yet she was not helped, but only grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. She said, "If I but touch his clothes, I shall be cured." Immediately her flow of blood dried up. She felt in her body that she was healed of her affliction. Jesus, aware at once that power had gone out from him, turned around the crowd and asked, "Who has touched me? Who has touched my clothes?" But his disciples said to Jesus, "You see how the crowd is pressing upon you, and yet you ask, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. The woman, realizing what had happened to her, approached in fear and trembling. She fell down before Jesus and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has saved you. Go in peace and be cured of your affliction." While he was still speaking, people from the synagogue official's house arrived and said, "Your daughter has died. Why trouble the teacher any longer?" Disregarding the message that was reported, Jesus said to the synagogue official, "Do not be afraid, just have faith." He did not allow anyone to accompany him inside except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they arrived at the house of the synagogue official, he caught sight of a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. So he went in and said to them, "Why this commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but asleep." And they ridiculed him. Then he put them all out. He took along the child's father and mother and those who were with him, and entered the room where the child was. He took the child by the hand and said to her, "Talith kaum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." The girl, a child of 12, arose immediately and walked around. At that, they were utterly astounded. He gave strict orders that no one should know this, and said that she should be given something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord. A few weeks back, I realized that my truck had passed 70,000 miles, and I probably needed to do something about the brake pads. They had not changed them, or haven't changed since I bought them. But the prices are ridiculous, as you all know, so I thought, you know what? I'll try to do it myself, save a few bucks. I've done it before, but it's been a c- couple of years, maybe 6 or 8 years. So I did like any of us would do when we have a self-project. I went on YouTube and found a video on how to change brake pads on an F-150 pickup truck. I went through the process, watched the video, did what the guy said, changed the pads out. Luckily the rotors were fine, didn't need to do that. Put it all back together, and then I got a little nervous. I had to have faith that the guy in this video was right, because I was about to drive this truck, and if he was wrong, nothing was going to stop me, maybe another car or a tree or a house or something. So complete blind faith of a stranger I'd never met giving a YouTube video on how to change brakes. Luckily it worked, my truck's still intact and I'm still here. But there are many opportunities that we have to practice faith in our life. Those of us know this when it comes to family life. We, as children, we place faith in our parents that they are going to do the best and right by us, that they have our best interests at heart. Doesn't always work out in every family, but that's the gist of it. Similarly, when it comes to our jobs, that we have faith in the company that we're working for, that if we show up, if we come on time, we do our job, we do it to the best of our ability, that a paycheck will come at the end of the week, or every 2 weeks, or whatever it may be, and that the job's gonna be there, hopefully, for a long time, for the duration. That's the faith that we place in that company. And certainly, most importantly, we have to have faith in God. Faith in God that tells us that he sent his only begotten Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, his word made flesh, into the world to save us from our own sinfulness, to save us from the evil that has been brought into the world, and give us an opportunity to accept his offer of salvation, so when this world is over, we can live with him in the next for all eternity. We see in the first reading that when God created the world, he created it perfectly. He created man and women in his own image and likeness, and they were perfect. There was no sin. There was no death. There was no illness. But through the sin of Adam and Eve trying to make themselves out to be like God, have the same knowledge of God, evil entered into the world. The devil was allowed in, and with it came all sorts of problems, illness, suffering, death, disease, all the things that God did not want. But he also had a plan to save his creation, mankind, from itself. He would send his Son into the world. And people that believed in his Son, that had faith in Jesus Christ, would accept this salvation. In today's gospel, Jesus is approached by a synagogue official named Jairus. He was a high up in the Jewish faith. A synagogue official is a pretty important position. But as we know, most of the higher-ups, the Pharisees, the scribes, the Sadducees, didn't have faith in Jesus. They didn't believe he was the Messiah that was supposed to come to the world. Jesus didn't meet their definition of what they were looking for. They were looking for someone that was going to come and throw off the Roman Empire and give them back their own kingdom. But God's salvation plan wasn't about what took place in the earth, but around what takes place after our life in this world is over, a complete salvation. So anyway, we see this man, Jairus, come forward, and he has faith in Jesus. He asks him if he can come and cure his daughter that's dying. That took a lot of guts for him to go, especially in front of a large crowd. Most people probably knew who he was. Of course, Jesus says, sure, let's go. And while they're on the way, we see in the same gospel account of a woman who's been suffering horribly, says for 12 years, hemorrhaging, bleeding, couldn't stop it, spent all of her savings on doctors that couldn't help her, made it worse. But she knew, if she just touched his clothes, she would be cured. She had faith. And of course that happened. And Jesus turns around once no one touched her, and she's trembling, she's afraid. She thought she did something wrong. Jesus wasn't looking to accost her or to criticize her or anything. He wanted to know so he could give her an even greater gift. Not only was her physical ailment, these things that came in and entered into the world as a result of the evil brought by the devil, not only was that cured, but Jesus tells her because she had faith, she was saved. And what that means is not just her physical ailment was cured, But for all eternity, she believed in Jesus. She had faith in the name of the Son of God. She was going to spend her eternity in the kingdom of heaven. Her faith had saved her. Then Jesus moves on to get to Jairus' house. They tell him the girl's dead, don't bother him anymore. He doesn't listen to him. In fact, he's mocked and ridiculed by the people there when he says the girl's just asleep, so he puts them all out. And he says something very important to the synagogue official. Do not be afraid, just have faith. And he did. The official had faith in Jesus Christ. And of course, Jesus raises the girl up, gives her back to her parents, tells her to give them something to eat. And undoubtedly, a massive conversion took place in at least that household and probably the other households that surrounded his. They began to have faith too that Jesus was the one that they were waiting for. Jesus is the Messiah that they've been praying for so long. We also have to have faith in Jesus Christ. And it's very important in this day and age because it seems like our world is being turned upside down. We're constantly being told by experts to not only believe things that go against the teachings of the gospel, but also that go against common sense. Things that we've known our whole lives. God created man and woman, that's it. There's nothing else. Abortion is not health care. It's killing an innocent child in the womb of its mother. But if we disagree with these things, the rest of the world tells us that we're wrong. We're intolerant. We're doing the wrong things, and sometimes they may get angry at us, or worse, cancel, or whatever else may be, or maybe even violent. Jesus never said following him was going to be easy. All we have to do is ask his disciples. All but one of them suffered martyrdom because of Jesus. But he did say it was worth it. So when the tough decisions come in our day and age, in our life, daily or weekly, or whatever it may be, we have to put our faith in Jesus Christ and following the message of the gospel, no matter what the rest of the world tries to convince us of, because there has to be an ultimate truth. Faith is having a belief, a trust in someone or something, and that's what Jesus asks us to do. That no matter how difficult it becomes here in the world, how much of a struggle we may have to endure, he wins in the end. And if we place our faith in him, we also will be with him in the end. And we don't need a YouTube video to show us that or to explain that to us. We have the scripture. We have the gospel. We have the example given by Jesus Christ. The fact that we're all here today indicates that we do have faith in Jesus. Hold on to that faith and turn to him in time of need.
As
As one community gathered in Christ, we offer the following prayers.
That as we celebrate our nation's independence this week, we may give thanks to God for the gift of our national freedoms, including religious freedom, and seek to acquire the spiritual freedoms that God desires for us. We pray to the Lord. For spiritual conversion in our nation, and for the preservation of religious liberties and all life from conception to natural death, we pray to the Lord. For Pope Francis's prayer intention for the month of June, that migrants fleeing from war or hunger, forced to undertake journeys full of danger and violence, find welcome and new opportunities in the countries that receive them, we pray to the Lord. That through the intercession of Our Lady of Prompt Succor, we may be spared damage to life and property during this hurricane season, we pray to the Lord. For all who are afflicted with physical, mental, emotional, or spiritual illness, that they may know the grace and help of Jesus our healer, we pray to the Lord. For our deceased loved ones, for the recently deceased, especially Kenny McCaffrey, we pray to the Lord. We now pause to add our own attentions in silence. We pray to the Lord. Please join in saying our family prayer on the inside, front cover of the gathered hymnal. Following that prayer, we'll recite a Hail Mary for peace in Ukraine and the Middle East, and for the cause of life and godly values in our nation. Loving and faithful God,
through the ears of the people of our hearts, God.
Please join in singing our offertory hymn number 854, Healer of Our Every Ill, number 854, Eat Your Bread, Gather Your Home.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. O God, who graciously accomplished the effects of your mysteries, grant, we pray, that the deeds by which we serve you may be worthy of these your sacred gifts, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death. And by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Gregory, our Bishop, and all those who, holding on to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them, we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer for themselves and hope all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, and hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be blessed, O Lord, we pray. Be pleased, O Lord, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord, Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O Lord, his Almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. This pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them, as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us, who through this participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who those sinners, open your abundant mercies. Graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, hallowed be thy will, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." The Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should come.
You shall wander far in safety.
Let us pray. May this divine sacrifice we have offered and received fill us with life, O Lord, we pray, so that, bound to you in lasting charity, we may bear fruit that lasts forever. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for our announcements. The Chosen Season 4, episode 4, will be shown in St. Joseph Hall this Wednesday, July 3rd. In the episode, a Roman centurion asks Jesus to heal his grievously ill son. And a complimentary meal will be available at 6 p.m. if ordered by Monday. The scripture reading and video will begin at 6:30 p.m. The 4th of July concert, our 4th of July concert, is tomorrow at 3 p.m. in the church with Sarah Jane Mann and Lyndon. All are invited. The Knights will serve free hot dogs in the gym before the concert. And special thanks to Crescent City Physical Therapy and Neil and Janet Mackey for being major sponsors for the concert. We'll host an exhibition of Eucharistic Miracles on the weekend of July 20th to 21st. See the bulletin for details. We are selling tickets to two major August events after Mass today in the back of the church. The St. Francis Xavier Parish Retreat is the first one, which will take place on August 2nd to 4th, with 10 talks and 3 meals, and the 100th anniversary dinner dance on August 24th is the second, at Metairie Country Club, with the side B band. Both events are $55 a person, cash, check, or credit card after Mass. And the anniversary celebration dinner dance, we've already sold 47 out of 240 tickets. And for the retreat, we've already sold 24 out of 140. So you want to get those before they all sell out. The space is limited for both. Due to the 4th of July holiday this week, most ministries and activities will be closed. The Adoration Chapel and Church office will close on Wednesday afternoon and reopen the following Monday. We wish you a blessed and happy 4th of July and a blessed 13th Sunday of Ordinary Time. Please stand for the final blessing of this Christmas. The Lord be with you.
And with you.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace and glorify the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God. Sing my name to our King.
Defend us in God. We are protection against the wickedness and scares of the devil. May God lead you in your prayer, and you God will rest in heaven with us. By the power of God, Christ and God of Satan, and all evil spirits, who crop up the word of Satan and Jesus Christ.
Please join in singing our closing hymn, number 206, Blessed Be Your Name, number 206, in your Blue Spirit's album.